this nice introduction. Thanks again to the organizers for organizing this whole event. Well, welcome to the keynote. It's about why you will be contributing to Drupal. If I look around the room, there's quite a few people I recognize, and I think quite a few of you already are contributing. So in this case, take it as an encouragement on why you will continue to contribute, or why you get your colleagues to actually join us as well. I'll just start with basically with a survey I was sent a few years ago, just before Drupal 8 came out. Because at that stage I was a member of the documentation working group. So I got sent a survey that started with the first question. How many contributors are in your project? 1 to 2, 2 to 5, 5 to 10. And I was just coming back from DrupalCon in Barcelona. I said, 2 to 5? That's not even enough for a module. So more than 2,000. And that's just only core. That doesn't even count contribute. I think by now we had an issue that actually had 1,600 people credited on it. That was the getting the multilingual into core. So, and then the next question was, what's the minimum programming experience of contributors? 1 to 2 years, 2 to 5, 5 to 10 years? And I was thinking, huh? You just contacted me because I'm doing documentation, so minimum requirement for coding? None. However, we do have all these people that are contributing on all kinds of different levels. And I just want to give you some examples before I then tell you more about... Well, first of all, there are all these people that are actually contributing, because together we actually make this awesome software that can be used for so many different things. But still, we also need 2,000 people. Really isn't enough, obviously. We do need more people. We want people with fresh ideas, with different backgrounds, to come and actually help us making this software. So, just a bit about me first. I'm actually a biologist by training. I'm a scientific editor. I'm also a political activist. I've never learned Well, actually, I did learn Pascal at some stage, but I've never learned PHP or anything. I'm a Drupal site builder. I'm a member of the documentation working group for Drupal, and I'm participating in the UX team. And somehow I ended up moving from documenting the quirks, to actually fixing things in Drupal. So I started by my second DrupalCon in Paris when I went to the sprint, simply because I was still in the city. And I go there to the sprint and I was asked, so what are you working on? Nothing really. Can you have them code this and this? I don't know PHP. Have you Drupal 7 installed? Drupal 7 wasn't out at that stage. Do you have it installed? No. So I was told to go into this room that had about 5 people and didn't have a table, and someone said, okay, just follow the instructions on the website, see whether you can install it. So I'm sitting there installing, and it kind of worked. It was a bit cumbersome. And I realized, well, it's actually the text on the website doesn't quite make sense. I can change that. I'm a scientific editor. I do know how to write proper sentences to explain things. So I started from actually changing things on the website. With Drupal 8, I ended up pretty much going through every single help text of all the, 65 modules in Drupal 8, because we were making sure that the help text of the modules are proper. And then at some stage I decided, it's a bit annoying to document the things that are broken. Let's fix them so we don't have to write the documentation. So this is why I'm now doing the weekly meetings of the UX team, and you're welcome to join if you have any problems or you think, this should be fixed. We are open for more ideas, and especially more people who actually know where things aren't useful. So also some more people that are contributing to Drupal, because just to show you the variety of people that are contributing. This is Roy Scholten. You, Roy. He's one of Drupal's newest core maintainers and product manager. And when I asked him how he got into Drupal, he actually sent me this text. He said, I'm an illustrator by education and interaction designer by trade. In my contributions, I focus on visually clarifying the problem and suggesting possible solutions. This enables people to agree on what to build next. So that's a core maintainer, a product manager who doesn't do any code. He helps people to figure out what to do. Somebody else, Jenny DC from the UK. I asked her how she got into Drupal. I said, well, I figured out how Drupal works because I was doing theming, and I was wondering where the things were coming from in the themes. So, and then I got really annoyed, and so I taught myself enough PHP to actually write the module that I needed. Or the short summary, I got into Drupal by swearing a lot. JP Stacy, also from the UK, he's a physicist by training, but he said, well, I didn't really want to stay into science, but I really like the kind of visualization of scientific data. So that led me to actually content management. Like, I came into Drupal kind of sideways, like crap. He's now one of the people that pretty much at every DrupalCon I've been to is doing the mentoring for new contributors. And then we have Gabor. Gabor also the maintainer for Drupal 6 or 7, one of those. And he said, well, I actually have a degree in computer sciences, but it took me longer to finish it because I was organizing conferences, translating books, doing security training for adults. And without all of those things, I actually wouldn't be where I am now. And a lot of the things he's currently doing is not actually coding. It's not much more like making things going, keeping the multilingual initiative going, those kind of things. And there's lots of other people in there, and I think there's enough to actually do a whole Drupal pub quiz round on that. There's lots of different IT backgrounds that people come from there. I think we have a chef and a historian, we have a carpenter, we have, for some reason, enough musicians to sometimes actually have a small concert during an event. So all of these people are contributing from all of their very different backgrounds. And typically when you look at expertise, people have this kind of picture in mind. You have like the beginners, the intermediates, the experts, or you have the users, the kind of site builders, front-end developers, and the real developers. And all of that leads to this magic thing, this magic software at the top. And I think for Drupal that isn't actually true. I think Drupal's expertise looks more like this. We have lots of different kinds of expertise. We have the core development, we have the contrib modules that are getting developed, we have documentation, we have the organizing of events, design and theming, we have usability and accessibility, mentoring, translation, and also your specific project, your specific website that you're working on. All of that feeds into something that overlaps to make Drupal what it is. So I don't think we have this clear hierarchy of saying this is more important than the other. We have lots of overlap, and I think we have lots of different things. I'm sure there's people who write awesome PHP code and have no idea how to theme a website. And the other way around, so. So the question is more, why do people not contribute? Because if I look at all of this expertise we can bring in, well, I went to a talk on Wednesday in Amsterdam where somebody had done a proper study for university about looking at Drupal shops to see why are people not contributing. And he came up with three different points. It's mainly lack of knowledge, or the perceived lack of knowledge, lack of time, and doubts. And I will just go through a few of them. His data is much more academically presented in a talk that he and Jamie do together, something about horses and water and getting them to drink. You might have seen that session at other times, so that's definitely worth, if only to see the two of them bouncing off each other. So I would say knowledge is simply something you know. If you find a bug, you know something. You know that there's something broken. And it's worth reporting that. It's worth filing an issue for that. Because without anybody saying there's a bug, nobody's going to go and fix it. So it doesn't matter if you don't know how to fix it. It doesn't matter if you know what's really broken. It's only important that you say, I noticed this, this doesn't work. I tell somebody about it. Preferably in a way that's not just like, it's broken, but in a way that actually says, okay, this is what I was trying to do, this is what I expected would happen and it didn't. Or in case you're wondering what this is actually the first physical bug that was ever found. Gary Popper in 1947 actually found a physical bug on what is a panel F, and she put it in their logbook, which is the equivalent of an issue now. So she could have also dusted it off on the floor and nobody would have known it existed. But that's a documented bug. And sometimes it just needs a fresh pair of eyes, a different look at things. This is a cover picture of Science from 99 or 97. A woman I studied with actually discovered the largest bacteria ever. And they were on a trip to look for other sulfur bacteria off the coast of Namibia. They couldn't really find the bacteria they were looking for. But there were all these white dots that they could see with a naked eye. And they were asking somebody on this research vessel, what are these things? And people said, well, no idea. We see them all the time. It must be some kind of microorganism. I mean, big enough you can see it. That's usually microorganisms. And she was basically sitting down, taking this out and putting it under the microscope, having to scale out because they were so big. And she looked at them and said, they do look like bacteria. They have all the characteristics of bacteria. The only thing that doesn't fit is they're too big. So by coming from a different angle, like she figured out, or she was able to see something that was completely there all the time. But just by looking at it from a different angle, you might sometimes see something. I have a similar issue when sometimes I'm dealing with a review of an issue and I'm too lazy to roll out another very fresh Drupal 8 install, and I just make a branch and put it into my thing I'm currently working on. And then suddenly you see other things that are happening. Like when you test a patch, you usually don't say, oh, let's set up this site in multilingual, for example. But if you put it into an existing program, project, you see that actually this doesn't really work on multilingual sites, for example, or this doesn't really work if you also have other content entities or so. So sometimes that actually looking at a patch, looking at a module in real life settings, can also give a very different idea of what's going on. So that's another way of differently looking at the same thing. And then that's again for the session on Wednesday. Well, actually, if you do patches and reviews are training, so whoever committed a patch and had it completely shut down because it doesn't really work at all, did you get any kind of feedback that made it better, that made it workable? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, usually if you make a patch and it doesn't work, people come back and say, this doesn't work, maybe it's this or that, or this doesn't follow the standards. So you basically get free training along the way. You might be afraid of saying, oh, like so-and-so has written this awesome quote, I can't really touch it, but actually you can. They will just tell you how to make it better. So that's free training you get with every review. And that does increase your knowledge as well. Like, I know about coding standards simply because I need to put text into the module for the book help text. And then there's doubts. There's this big what if. What if my code isn't good enough? What if I start it and it doesn't work? What if people look at me like I'm really stupid? Why did I even bother doing this? Why? What if my boss tells me that I shouldn't spend time on these things? And I think, well, most of these concerns, yes, they're fine to have, but they're also fine to disregard. In general, Drupal is a very engaging community. People are actually interested in patches that make things work. So people are not interested in going and saying, you're stupid, you don't make a patch. We want Drupal to be a better software, which is why we do review things. And while I was writing this talk, I was actually this Twitter conversation between Sam Boyer, which is one of the previous co-maintainers for C-Tools, and also one of the main driving factors behind moving from SVG to Git. For moving to Git. and Earl Myers, Merlin of Chaos, who is the C-Tools and Views developer, and one of my personal Drupal heroes, because Views was just the awesome thing when it happened. And Sam was basically saying, well, I wonder if my constant feeling of struggling to keep up is because I find it too gross to appropriate or to use other people's ideas. And Earl Meyer basically replied by saying, well, there's few truly original ideas. Nothing I contribute to Drupal I would call original. So you don't have to have this feeling, this aspiration of making something really good, awesome, original. And even in our awesome co-contributors thing, they're not doing anything original, and that's fine. And then time. Yes, contributing does take time. But also, I think time is relative. It does take time to commit a bug. But if that means your bugs get fixed, brilliant, you've earned time. Quite often, if something is broken in a project I'm working on, I need to write an issue anyway, so either me or the people I'm working with can fix it. I might just as well submit that to Drupal.org as well. I was building a site in summer where we used YAMLform, which is now WebForm, there was something that didn't quite work as I needed it. So I was writing up the issue for ourselves to fix it, and I copied it into the issue queue as well because I'd already written it. And I'm working along for the rest of the day, and then I check my email in the evening. So, I got a message from the maintainer. That's a really good idea. I fixed it. It's committed. So I'm like, wow. I just magically got this. It's not always such a clear cut, but in general, I think the time you put into Drupal, into submitting bugs, submitting reviews. I mean, if you use a patch, you need to see whether it works for you. So you might as well just say also in the issue queue, it works for me. If some of your colleagues review it, because before it goes into your project, into your client, you have a second review that you can actually also put on Drupal.org, and you're already pretty close to say, okay, this is RTBC. So I'd say, yes, it takes time, and it takes time to sit here on a Saturday morning, but I think it's worth it, and you're getting it back in some way or the other. So if you now think, oh, but my bus, but my budget, and it won't really fit, well, basically, all the things that are good for you as an individual contributor are also good for your bosses and your budget. You get extra reviews. If you submit your patch into the issue queue and somebody reviews it, brilliant. Somebody else looked at the code that you're gonna move on to your clients. You have less technical debt. If you patch something that's broken only locally and don't tell anybody about it, next time that module is getting updated, you have to reapply a patch. And sometimes you might have to reroll your patch because nobody knows that your patch exists. If it's getting committed, then you have the great thing that you don't have to patch it again locally. You get extra development time because somebody else might have already done this. We were looking at, I think, the file sizes of attached files. Made an issue because, we need to display file sizes not in bits but in kilobytes. So you make an issue, think, oh, I should work on that. You do a quick search and you see that actually somebody already has done that. There's a patch for that. You get extra documentation, and documentation is quite often still missing. You get extra training. I mean, most of your bosses probably wouldn't say, let's fly in Alex Fodge, Janet Fodgkins, also to give you a one-on-one training this afternoon. But you do get that training from them when they reply to your issues. you get extra time if it works out. And quite often it overlaps already with the kind of default workflows of lots of organizations anyway. If you're patching something that's broken, some of your colleagues, somebody else probably should look at it before you actually commit it. So you might just as well do it twice. Doesn't that take that much more time? So, now that I've convinced you on that you can contribute something, your boss will be happy with it as well. The question is, what can you actually do? Well, I would simply say, do the kind of things you know and the kind of things you like doing. Whatever it is, if you are into design, submit some stuff into the theming and the design issues. If you like reviewing things, if you like working on UI text, basically, there is really nothing in Drupal where we actually have too many people already. So there's always a space for you to contribute something. But also start small. Start with something that you can handle in the time that is available. There's sometimes patches that are really only very small, but they still need fixing. I think I've had one issue where we just only fixed a typing error. It makes a hell of a difference for lots of users who are not wondering what the sentence means. And we don't actually, nobody's asking you to, from the way go, to commit to 15 hours per week and a tattoo. You just can start with the time you have. Pick issues if you're participating in a sprint, pick an issue you can actually do in a day and take it from there. It's really frustrating if you start on something that is too big and keeps on lingering on your head. You come from a sprint or so, and you say, I still need to finish this. And then you go to a sprint a year later and think, I should pick this up again. So do on something that is actually feasible in the time you have available and, extend from there. And then, contribution is not just code. There's patches, and by now they're not only code, they're also configuration. And I'll come to an example of that later. Bug reports. If you find something that's broken, write a proper bug report. That's a hell of a lot of a difference. If a maintainer looks at an issue and says, I don't know how to reproduce this, then it won't get done. If you sit down and say, okay, I tried it out, it really is not my strange settings. I used this and this modules together, so this is what I was looking for. Then that's something useful. That's something where somebody can start from. Reviewing issues. Somebody said that most of the issues on Drupal.org are currently on needs review. And reviewing can be something as simple as, this actually works for me, or this is useful for me, or this follows or doesn't follow the coding standards. You can also, kind of partially review something by saying, this is the thing I can look at. Documentation. There's still a hell of a lot of documentation to be written, unfortunately, and every time we add a new experimental module to Drupal 8, we have to write that documentation again as well. So we now have something like workflows and inside out block placement in there, and the documentation for that doesn't exist. It's still in a flux, but basically at the moment it's really hard to say, how should I even use this thing? It's actually also an awesome way of learning what Drupal does. When Drupal 8 came out, I pretty much had tried out every single module, simply because I needed to see whether documentation was done for everything correctly. So by writing documentation, you also learn out every single button and every single tick box and what they do. Usability and accessibility. There's a lot of things we can still do there. Sometimes that's lots of the kind of big projects, like workflows that are improving usability, but there's also lots of small bits and pieces where it isn't quite obvious what you need to do, or whether texts are too complex. And accessibility, actually Drupal has lots of accessibility built in, lots of accessibility people don't even know about. Like when you use a screen reader and you look at the extended page and you start searching for it, and the number of modules becomes less and less, the screen reader actually tells you that you now have only 10 items left on the site. So there's lots of accessibility already built in, but also lots of improvement there. Design and theming. Morten will probably tell you that we still treat themers and designers as second-rate citizens. So go ahead. Mentoring. Mentoring is a lot about actually getting other people started, telling or showing people how to actually do how the Drupal workflow works with patches and interdicts and things like that. Getting people set up to actually use Drupal, or sometimes being simply available if somebody says, how did I do that? Where did I find how this new way of the routing table now works? That's also already mentoring. It's kind of 5 minutes that you answer somebody's question. And organizing events. That's also a big contribution to the community, I think. Because events like this are for actually sharing information, getting your personal training, building this community, and it needs a hell of a lot of work. So that's definitely something anybody can pitch in. And translation. We have great Drupal in 8, but we don't want everybody who works in a different language to continuously have to figure out what the hell this might mean. So let me give you some inspiration on a few things you could do. Improving usability. I like usability, so I'm going to pitch some examples of things you can actually do with very little effort in here. This is an issue that I came across when I was building the first Drupal 8 sites. That's the content page, which is now a view, and somehow the filters were in the wrong order as the columns underneath. So I kept on swapping them around. And at that stage I thought, this is ridiculous. Why am I swapping that around? Why is it in the wrong order anyway? So I made an issue and it's patched now. So in Drupal 8.3, they are in the right order. And that is basically a configuration patch. The any site builders in the room? Anybody who know how to make a view? Okay, all of you could have fixed this. Because it is just a view, and you export the configuration, and you make a patch from it, which is basically saving it as a patch on a certain name, and you're done. That's a Drupal core contribution, that thousands of people around the world will have a better usability experience with that. And there's a few more of them hidden away in Drupal. And then there's another issue for which I really actively like some help. And this is our current admin menu, where Rachel Northrop and me think there's something fundamentally wrong with the admin menu, because we're not able to place things where we'd like to place them in there. And we're now looking for other people that have problems with trying to place pages in there, or experiences of people that say, we always make a new admin menu, for example, because this and that is the reasons. So if you have 5 minutes, go to this issue and tell us your experience, your usual workarounds of fixing this. And if you do that, we will be able to credit you on probably the most disruptive change to Drupal 8. Because apparently all our training materials are currently based on that this is the order of things. So we're talking at Dev Days in Sevilla about whether this would make sense to do. And the answer was probably, but we need a really good reason for it, because it will be quite disruptive. So if you have 5 minutes, tell us how you're changing the admin menu. Another thing where we need where we need help that doesn't take long is translations. Because I think the user interface still has bits and pieces that are not translated into German. Which means, I think lots of the front-facing text is actually in German now, but lots of the text in the back, there are still English words or English phrases mixed into it. So it would be awesome if that is already in German, but it also means if that is actually translated into German, it becomes possible to also translate the whole Drupal 8 user guide into German without having to say, and then click on this link with this English word on it. And I think, Michael, you're doing a session about the user guide today. So if you want to know more about the Drupal 8 user guide, there's a session today. And then events. Well, I think events are things that really hold the Drupal community together, but also makes it very easy for people to actually join, to do things. So I think Drupal camps like this are the kind of, we're showing the world how awesome Drupal is. It's for us to come together and learn from each other, learn about a module that you haven't really used before, learn about how the hell to work with this configuration, and those kind of things are really important. So lots of the camps are still kind of DIY. We work because we put our time in, and I think that's a really good, important thing of the Drupal community. So if you have any time to spare helping organizing an event, and that might only be running around and finding a cable to connect the laptop to the beamer, or contributing sessions. Sessions are also a really good way of actually getting into understanding Drupal from a slightly different angle. There's one thing about knowing where to click to make things work or how to put in a certain code. But when you put it on a slide, you have to think about things in a different way. So it's a really good way of actually teaching yourself, training, getting feedback. So I can only encourage you to help organizing events and to submit sessions, and of course to join the sprints and events. So that are my kind of three easy things you could do this weekend. And with this, I'm coming on to rounding this up. I told you I would tell you why you will be contributing to Drupal, and well, basically because you already do. You already do by being here, I'd say. Because contributing is good for you. And because Drupal needs that kind of diversity of contributors to be a better software, a better product, and a better community. Thank you. Questions. In that case, like questions on how can I start, and then we can see whether there's anybody who in the room who can help you with that, or any things where you think, oh, that's another good way of contributing. Oh, yeah.
One thing I think we're increasingly finding is that it's harder for people to have issues that take a day. Because, for example, I started in 2011, and Jennifer helped me to get my first patch in, and the API documentation was completely non-existent at that time. So there were lots of easy ways in. And I think often new people, it's a courageous step for them to go into a sprint room in the first place. But then secondly, they get very stuck in a deep morass. And on the Fridays, I've started even telling people like him, find novice issues for us, because the novice issues are...
Yeah, just to shortly summarize that, the point was that it seemed to be becoming more difficult to find issues that are actually solvable in a day. But I think actually, that's also an obligation that that maintainers have. Is yes, you could make one issue that is this big and has a 3 years of issue creep on it, or you could say, okay, we can actually take this out and fix it independently of the rest. I think GitLab has a philosophy of the minimal viable change. What's the smallest thing we can change without breaking something? So sometimes it's also fine to actually say, instead of making this one enormous issue that says, let's rewrite abuse, make an issue that says, okay, this is one thing that needs fixing. I have one issue that I want to actually work on today, and that's a typing error in Essence. That really annoys me, and I think it's confusing. So I think by actually making issues that are small and have small things that can get fixed, it's an obligation of the people that have an overview to actually make sure that we have these issues, and that yes, that we also take them as novice issues, and that at events where we have mentors at Sprint, there I think also is already a good system in place to make sure that we can show, lead people to these kind of issues. But yeah, I think otherwise it's also certainly at Sprint's fine to go up to someone and say, I've got this and this amount of time. What is useful for me to start with? Any other questions, comments? Need for coffee? Well, if you have any other questions later, just come and talk to me or ask anybody else for where you would like to help. Thanks a lot.